Hey, brother, I'm working on a song and I could use your help. What rhymes with bunny?
Honey, money, sunny, funny, which this is not. Please, I'm working on a sermon.
What rhymes with hard-boiled egg?
I don't know. Yard soiled Greg? I'm busy.
And chocolate?
Nothing rhymes with choc... Wait. What in the world are you working on?
A hymn for Easter Day.
Are you open to a little constructive criticism?
That's never stopped you before.
Easter isn't just a celebration of something that happened long ago. We celebrate that Christ the Lord is risen today.
Hallelujah. That's good.
At Easter, love's redeeming work is done.
Let me write this down. Is done.
Saw we now where Christ has led, following our exalted head. Made like him we rise.
So, no bunnies, hard-boiled eggs, or chocolate. Got it.
Ours the cross, the grave, the skies.
Hallelujah. The church. It's beautiful, isn't it? But what is church? It's funny how you can always learn something about someone if you just ask them a question with the word church in it. What church do you belong to? Are you getting married in a church? Or my favorite, where's the church potluck? But is that the extent to which we understand church, the never-ending search for the perfect tuna noodle casserole? What does church mean? Why is the church here? And why is it important? Is there something else that we could be missing? Well, that's why we'll take a crack at defining church, because as we like to say around here, Chuck knows church. Simply put, church is a noun, most commonly thought of as a building where religious services take place, in particular, Christian worship services. Now, that would be true for the English word church, but for the Greek word, it literally means called out, or in common Greek usage, people called out to assemble together for a civic purpose. Sounds like the church is an awful lot like the Avengers. So, if we're being biblical, the word we translate as church does not refer to a building or a place at all, but the people who come together as the body of Christ. Now, for Christians, many believe the first church was established in Jerusalem on Pentecost, following Jesus' resurrection and ascension into heaven. The apostles were all together with other followers of Jesus Christ. The rush of a violent wind swept through the place, and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and the church was born. But we can't miss the most important part of church for us today, right? The why. Why is there church? We know what it is, how it began, but without an understanding of the why the church, well then, why the bother? Am I right? All right, like we said, church is a place for worship. We've established that. Worship being the unique function of the church, right? A place to gather in Jesus' name where members share their faith. So, it's God's church, where Jesus Christ is the center of our lives, where it is the mission of the church to make disciples. The church is about God's purpose. God's purpose, not our own. God, through Jesus, shows us how we can live in love, how we can honor God, and how we can love and serve others. Now that's church. If you'd like to know more, be sure to ask your pastor. Tell them Chuck sent you.
Good morning from First United Methodist Church. Let's worship.
Good morning. Wonderful to see all of you together this morning with us to begin our worship. We are going to sing our first hymn, Amazing Grace. That's number 378 in your hymnal. Let's stand and sing together. We're singing verses 1, 2, 3, and 6. Apostles' Creed, which is printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning and welcome back to your favorite weekly program, Children's Time with Connor. I'm your host, Connor, and I'm super excited to bring you another week of Children's Time. Another week of fun, science experiments, and bring y'all some lessons from the Bible that Pastor Chris is going to talk about this morning. So today, I don't have not one, not two, but three special guests to bring y'all fun activity and bring you some Bible knowledge as well. Does that sound fun? Awesome. Well, gather around and come join as this is Children's Time with Connor. Roll it. Awesome. Sorry, I did not know my cat was on the chair when I decided to do that spin. But awesome. First thing is first is we have a fun experiment, right? I don't know if it's a science experiment, but it's a fun experiment and activity. And I got guests Riley and Ellie Smith, and they told me earlier this week that they could fill up a bag, a Ziploc bag of water, and take a pencil, a pen or something, stab the bag without losing any of its contents. I know, I'm just as intrigued as you all. So, let's throw it over, Ellie, Riley, already? All right, we're going to kick it over to you to show us this fun activity. All right, go for it.
Yeah, let's get into it. You take a Ziploc bag, fill it up with water, however
much. And a pencil,
okay?
What?
They don't care.
A pencil, you see right here.
Any kind of pencil or pen works. Here we go. In three, two, one. You did it wrong! You punched your...
Take it from me. It doesn't always plan out the way that we want it to, but sometimes people love a laugh just as much as if it went perfect. So thank y'all so much for trying. Okay. So I'm getting the news that the mechanical pencil, we think, was the problem. So is that right? Okay. So they're going to go and get a different pencil and try it again. All right. Sounds good. All right. Let's try it again. Y'all got it? Okay. Back over to y'all. Round two.
We're using a colored pencil because a mechanical pencil did not work. So here we go. I swear if this fails, I'm leaving.
Okay.
Okay. No! You did too hard! You're alone!
I love it. I love it so much. Now, even after watching those two videos, I still think I'm going to and want to try that activity this week. You know, I think that it is possible. I'm going to trust y'all that it is possible. So I think I'm going to try that this week. So if y'all want to try to do some, we'll call it science in the form of physics, right? If y'all want to try that activity, please let me know how it goes. But also remember, ask parents for permission and probably do this one outside. So, but thank you, Riley and Ellie, for that laugh and for bringing us that this morning. So now our next guest is coming to you live, thousands of years ago in Israel. Yes, you heard me that. You heard right. Live from thousands of years ago, we got one of Jesus's disciples, one of the people that walked around with Jesus when he was on this earth, in the Apostle Luke. And he's going to tell us a fascinating story about Jesus. What? Okay, I guess Luke is going to tell us about a meal that he had with Jesus. I guess that's cool. I was kind of hoping for one of those miracle stories. Okay, anyhow. All right, Luke, you there? All right, I'm going to take you all over to Luke, and he's gonna tell you something about Jesus and food this morning. All right, go ahead, Luke. Yes, good morning, and thank you, Connor, for having me on your show. And yes, I've been through lots of miracles. I've spent many times with Jesus, and while a simple meal does not sound as fun as miracles, but this meal, just like the rest of that, opened my eyes and showed me something amazing about Jesus and showed me something amazing that changed the way I thought and it changed the way I live. So while a simple meal doesn't sound as awesome as feeding 5,000 people or healing sick or raising Lazarus from the dead or healing a blind man, I could go on, I guess, but it has such a significance in our lives as Christians. But we start the story is me and my buddies, you all know, the 12 disciples. We're walking down the road. But here's the thing. At this time, it was shortly after that Jesus died, right? And we had not yet met Jesus again, right? You all read the story from John last week that talked about how we were all in the room and then we all had to see Jesus' hands, right? Well, this is a story before that. right? We all, what just happened was that Jesus died. We all saw that Jesus died, right? It's our rabbi, our teacher had died on the cross. And we're walking down the road, but what happened was that Mary came and told us that the tomb was empty, right? The tomb was empty, and so we're kind of like, what's going on, right? We saw Jesus die, but now the tomb is empty. So we're thinking, did somebody steal Jesus' body? What's going on? We were super confused, and so of course, hi. One second, all right? I gotta talk to the people. All right, bye. Sorry, kids. So, we're talking about the tomb being empty as us disciples, and we're talking about what's going on and why that happened, and all of a sudden, there's this guy that kind of is walking with us on the road and asks us what we thought about Jesus, and we're like, well, okay, and we told him, then all of a sudden, he's like, no, and we're like, whoa, sorry, bro, like, what happened? What's going on? And this guy talked to us and prophesied to us something from the Bible, so we're like, okay, what's real? And then this person revealed who he was by the meal that we shared together. You guessed it. The meal was bread and it was wine or grape juice. Bread and wine was the meal that he shared. And this meal opened all of our eyes because, as you all know, because you've read the stories, you've read all my readings, and you're welcome, is that the meal that we had before Jesus' death was bread and was wine. And Jesus talked about how what that represented and what that meant. And so one of the first meals, according to my record, that we had together after Jesus had rose from the dead was bread and wine. And when he shared that and when we had that and sat down together, we realized who he was, and we realized the significance of what just happened. Because Jesus was not just this prophecy. Jesus was God coming to us to fulfill everything that he said he was going to. So while bread and wine is cool, what's happening, it's actually that Jesus used these two symbols as something deeper, as something that not just something that we drink or we eat, but something that changes the way we think, changes the way we live. It opens our eyes to the world around us. So be thinking about that, is that sometimes the things that open our eyes and change us, come in the form of things we're not expecting, like simple things like bread and grape juice. So be thinking about that, and every time you're reading the Bible, be looking at symbols, stuff like this that doesn't seem that big, but Jesus uses the littlest things to make these awesome stories and these great examples. All right, thank you all so much for having me. I hope you all have a great Sunday. All right, talk to you soon, Connor. Bye. Thank you, Luke. And I'm sorry, at first I was like, what are we going to learn from a meal? But it's really interesting to think about that idea that to some people, bread and juice are just two items. But to us as Christians, they have such a deeper meaning. So today, as Brother Chris brings us the word from the book of Luke, listen to what Brother Chris has to say about communion and what Brother Chris has to say about what this bread and what this juice or this wine means to us as Christians. Thank you all for tuning in, and until next week, continue to be safe, continue to pursue God's word, and continue to find experiments and find ways to have fun. All right, love y'all. Hey, Brother Chris, take
good
it away.
Good morning. We welcome you to this time of worship with the people of the First United Methodist Church of Lexington, Tennessee, today on this third Sunday of the Easter season. We are glad to have you with us, and we hope that this will be a time of worship and renewal for you. Have a few announcements before you today. I wanted to let you know that It looks like we will still not be meeting in person for worship or other activities for several more weeks. We are still finalizing our plans for that based off of our bishop's advice. Be following our Facebook page for more information about that coming up soon. But know that we do miss you, and we look forward to being together in person again. But in the meantime, we will continue to have these worship experiences on Sunday mornings at 10:15 a.m., both on YouTube and Facebook. So please continue to join us for these times together. Connor and I are continuing our Wednesday night Bible studies. Last Wednesday night, we began a new series that we're calling United Methodism 101, talking about what it means for us to claim our heritage as Methodists and what that means for us to live as people of God in the world. So we hope that it will be a good time for you, something of a confirmation for adults. So we hope that you'll be able to join us Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. for that experience. We will be hosting in our church parking lot this afternoon from noon to 3. We will be hosting a COVID-19 drive-through testing site. So if you know of anyone who needs to be tested, would like to be tested at no charge for the coronavirus, we ask you to direct them to the parking lot between our church and First Bank so that they can be tested here this afternoon, the 26th. Thank you for helping us spread the word about that. And just so you know, the May and June upper room devotionals are available in the church office. If you would like to have one of those, and if you'd like to pick them up, please contact Patricia Western in our church office, and she will help to make arrangements for that. We continue to not have regular hours in the church office for now. We still will be responding to any voicemail messages and email messages that you leave us, so please do continue to use that. And as we begin to look forward to a time where we transition back to regular office hours, we will keep you up to date about that as well. And as always, we continue to greatly appreciate the financial support that many of you are providing for our church during these days. If you would like to do that, you may send a check to the church physical address at 27 East Church Street in Lexington, or you may use the Givelify link that is part of this post on Facebook and YouTube today, and that will allow you to give electronically. We continue to be grateful for all that you do to continue to spread God's love during these times. Right now, as we enter into a time of prayer together, we lift up those who have requested our prayers on their behalf. We lift up Danny Skates, James Hamilton, McCray Cagle, Tom Riney, Tracy Walker, all of the unspoken requests of our hearts, Matt Ujich, and we remember family and friends following the death of Karen Cummings. As we lift all of these, as well as all of the concerns of our own hearts to God, we invite you to be in an attitude of prayer. Once again this week, I will lead us through a time of prayer where I will offer a prayer request and then say, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you to respond by answering back, hear our prayer. Let us be in prayer together. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of the bread, we pray that you would open the eyes of our faith, that we may always behold Jesus in all of his redeeming work. Together today, we pray for the people of our congregation and of every congregation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who suffer and those in trouble, especially for the healing of all those who suffer from COVID-19, that you would heal them completely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For medical professionals and other essential workers in our healthcare system, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. for business owners and employees who face uncertain times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our government leaders, local, state, and national, that they make wise decisions on our behalf. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the church universal, its leaders, its members, and its mission, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for and alongside the entire communion of saints. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As disciples of Jesus and part of the body of Christ, we are bold to pray using the words that Jesus taught his first disciples, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As the people of God, I invite you to join together as we sing our doxology of praise to the name of God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ whose power bliss. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, that you'll never be enough.
Today's gospel lesson comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. I invite you now to listen and to read in your own Bibles as I read aloud. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to join with me at this time and pray with me and pray for me. And now may the words of my mouth and may the meditations of every one of our hearts, wherever we may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. One of the things that I can remember loving about as well as anything else when I was a kid are optical illusions. Did you ever spend any time reading through books of optical illusions or looking them up online? I don't know what it is exactly that I loved about them or why they remain so fascinating for so many of us today, but there's something fun about looking at something that you know objectively is tricking your brain. But your mind keeps on telling you that what you're seeing must be different from what's actually there. It's like some sort of magic trick, being able to recognize that what you see is not, in fact, what's really there. Sometimes seeing what's really there, seeing the truth of the world around us, is harder than we realize. Our eyes, alongside of our minds and our emotions, our eyes will only let us take in so much information at once so that we don't get completely overwhelmed by the magnitude and the infinite detail of the world around us. So that opens up a pretty big and maybe a scary question. How do we know that we are seeing and understanding what's really most important around us? How do we know that we're seeing what we really need to see? I think about all this week as I think about the multiple stories in the Gospels where people see Jesus after the resurrection, but they don't recognize Jesus for who he is. Not at first, anyway. We know that Mary Magdalene was the first person to see Jesus alive after his resurrection, but at first, she mistook him for the gardener until Jesus called her by name. In Luke chapter 24, we read a story about how Jesus appeared to his disciples, and at first, they think that he's a ghost before he allows them to touch his hands and his feet. And then, of course, also in Luke 24 is the story that we read together earlier, the story of the two followers of Jesus on the road to Emmaus together. We know that one of the followers is named Cleopas, while the other one remains anonymous. On that Sunday in which Jesus was raised from the dead, they found themselves walking from Jerusalem to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles away. It was a pretty long walk, and there isn't usually much to do on those long walks except to talk with whoever you happen to be walking with. So you better hope that you have a traveling companion that you can get along with and have good conversations with. Because if you don't, 7 miles can be a long way to walk in silence. Cleopas and his friend walked along toward Emmaus, talking about everything that had happened over the course of that previous week. How Jesus had ridden into Jerusalem to the shouts of Hosanna, but how he had been crucified as an enemy of the state and an enemy of the faith less than a week later. But then, of course, came the stories of that very morning when some women had gone to the tomb and come back babbling something about seeing angels and a missing body. It was all very confusing for Cleopas and his friend. They seemed to be weary from the whole ordeal, and maybe that's what prompted them to get out of the city entirely, go someplace a little safer, where people weren't stirred up quite as much. As the two were walking along and talking, they found themselves walking alongside another man who was traveling that road in the same direction. It was nobody they recognized. After listening for a while, this new man asked them, "What are you talking about?" And the man looked at the stranger with disbelief, and they asked him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" Cleopas started describing the mighty words and deeds of Jesus of Nazareth and how he had been crucified. He said that everyone had hoped that he would be the one to save Israel from their troubles, from their oppression, but now he was dead. Now, there was the little matter of the women who went to the tomb that morning and came back with the stories of angels and a tomb with no body, but when it was checked out later on by the rest of them, nobody else saw Jesus. At that point, the stranger took charge of the conversation. "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" And then the stranger started with the law of Moses, and he went through the writings and the prophets, and he showed how the events that had just happened to Jesus of Nazareth had actually brought to completion everything else that God had been doing for his people throughout their history. But it took more than just a logical explanation of the scriptures to bring Cleopas and his friend into a full understanding of what had occurred in Jerusalem that week. They didn't truly have their eyes opened until they arrived at their destination. The stranger they had befriended was getting ready to continue on with his travels, but the two invited the stranger to stay with them overnight and continue his travels in the morning. The stranger agreed to stay with them that night, and they prepared an evening meal to have together. And it was only when the stranger took the bread and lifted it and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the other men, only then were their eyes opened, and they recognized that this stranger was no stranger at all, but it was the risen Jesus. We don't know exactly what it was that caused them to recognize the Lord at just that particular moment. Maybe it was because that meal was so much like all the other meals that Jesus had been having with his followers over the previous 3 years, when he fed the 5,000 and ate with the scribes and Pharisees and had a last meal in an upper room with his disciples. That experience of eating together, that time of intimate table fellowship, was so powerful that it touched something deep inside the men that caused them to see with fresh eyes. They were no longer trapped in the blindness of an optical illusion. All of a sudden, they were seeing the truth. They were seeing the most important person, the most important reality that they could possibly see in that moment. But then, just as mysteriously, just as soon as the men recognized Jesus as the one who was eating that meal with them, the Lord vanished from their sight. I love that story, how these followers of Jesus had their eyes opened to the truth of the resurrection through the most ordinary of everyday activities, breaking bread, having a meal to eat together. On one level, all that they saw with their eyes, all that was sitting there in front of them, was the food that they were about to have for that evening meal. But when they truly allowed themselves to open the eyes of their hearts, they were all of a sudden seeing resurrection. They were seeing new life coming out of death. When they allowed God to open their eyes to see the ultimate truth of reality for them, that was what allowed them to experience everything else in the world in an entirely new way. Earlier, we got to see some of the photographs that y'all have been sending in over this past week. I appreciate those of you who participated in that little project that we talked about during our midday prayer times together. I asked folks to send me pictures of how they were experiencing love right now, what it was that love looked like to them during this time of isolation. On one level, what we saw were ordinary pictures of ordinary activities and people and objects and situations. There were pictures of pets and family members and food and telephones and masks. But at the same time, for those who have the eyes to see, they are also all pictures of love being put into action. They were signs of God's loving presence with us today. They were pictures of new life, resurrection life, even in the midst of what can feel like the oppression of death and decay all around us. Today, my prayer for you is that you will have the eyes of your hearts opened today, so that you will not just see the everyday stuff of life around you, but that you will be able to truly see the hand of God at work every day, blessing you with love and protection and community even during this time of being apart. I invite you to join with me, join with each other, join with the recording of the choir that we have as we sing together our closing hymn, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. This blessing today, remember that life is short and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who walk this journey with us. So be quick to love and make haste to be kind. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God be with you. Have a wonderful week.